9/11, it's the 22nd anniversary today of 9/11. I remember where I was lying on a sofa recovering from back surgery and was supposed to be lying there for 3 weeks. It was about 8 days in. I got a call from the Daily Mirror newsroom. I was the editor. I got straight in my car and drove to Canary Wharf, not even thinking that that might be a target itself. It was the most extraordinary day of my career and obviously horrendous in so many ways. Where were you when it happened?
I was walking across Asia. I'd been walking for about a year and a bit, and I didn't understand what had happened. I met a guy sort of probably a couple of days after 9/11, and he started trying to explain to me in Nepali. He said, you know, it's this tower in America and this plane hit it, and I thought this guy was crazy.
You had no awareness of it at all?
I was processing these words, but I was like, it's like he's telling me there's been some sci-fi attack in New York. So it wasn't until the 18th September I was arrested and accused of being an Al-Qaeda activist up on the Tibetan-Nepali border.
You are the least likely Al-Qaeda activist I've probably ever met.
So this is what I said. I said to the policeman, I said, I'm not a very likely Al-Qaeda activist. Mm. And he said, that's exactly why I think you are. It was like Inspector Clouseau.
The walk that you were on, and you carried on for a long time, you did 2 years in the end. It's an extraordinary thing to do, to just walk and walk and walk and walk. What was the motivation for that?
I had been briefly a British soldier, then I was a diplomat, and I felt that I was locked behind these embassy walls, and we were getting involved in these other countries. We had no idea what was happening. So I walked across Afghanistan just after 9/11. I walked through the winter of December, January, February, March, just the Taliban government fell. And it was changed my life, changed me as a politician, changed me as a diplomat, because I saw the gap between these villages I was in, where women had not been more than 2 hours walk from their village in their lives, where I could see drugs being traded, people with guns. And then I turn up in Afghanistan, in Kabul, and I hear the British government and the American government saying, every Afghan wants a gender-sensitive, multi-ethnic, centralized state based on democracy, human rights, and rule of law. And I thought, I can't even translate that into language they understand. So my life was changed. I mean, 9/11 was a horrible event, but it defined the next 10 years of my life. I was in Afghanistan, I was in Iraq, I was working to advise the US government, and I was trying to stand up against what I saw as the madness of how people were responding.
When you see what's going on in Afghanistan now with the Taliban just obviously taking back full control and oppressing women again in their millions, terrible poverty, what is the answer? I mean, Tobias Elba got into hot water for what was a very clumsy video he put out, but the central message that we should start engaging again with the Taliban. Did you have some sympathy with that?
I did have sympathy with that, because the truth is that when we sanction people like the Taliban, we don't change their behaviour. They're not trying to go shopping in Harrods. All you end up doing is punishing the Afghan people. These are some of the poorest people in the world. Very, very difficult to feed themselves over the winter. People selling their own organs to feed themselves. So I think we can find ways of providing assistance to the Afghans without going through the government. And sanctioning the government just makes the area poorer and more unstable.
And when you look at Ukraine, there's a sort of growing sentiment amongst some Republicans, to my surprise, in America, that America should yank the support, spend it at home, not on this latest foreign conflict. What's your view of what's happening there? I mean, do you think Ukraine can win? Is it incumbent on the West to ensure they can win? How far do we get involved?
I fear that Ukraine is getting like the Iran-Iraq war, which dragged on for 8 years. I think we're underestimating Russia's depth and strength and the nationalistic sentiment. I think it's going to be very difficult for Ukraine to break through the front lines. And even if they do, I don't think Russia's going away. And I think the threat to Putin isn't from the left, it's from the right.
You tell a story in your book of how, as an MP, you thought about killing yourself over a story of your constituents' trousers that went viral. You gave an interview where he says some of the farmers in the more remote parts of his constituency hold their trousers up with twine. He got picked up and he's accused of being a posh, you are, of being a posh Tory who thinks his voters are country bumpkins.
Yeah, it's a strange thing looking back at it over 12 years. I can see now that I was completely overreacting. What I'm trying to be honest about, I suppose, is as a new MP coming in, you feel a very special relationship with your constituents. I was very proud of Cumbria. I was very proud of the work I was doing. I said a stupid thing to a journalist, and suddenly it looks like I'm slagging off my own constituents. And I really felt everything had ended. I sort of felt...
It's extraordinary that you would feel it so deeply. I mean, how close did you come to acting on that impulse?
It's the only time in my life I have felt like that. I was walking down the street and I saw a lamppost and I thought, maybe I should hang myself on this lamppost.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Yeah. It's the only time in my life, but it was... And I think it shows something...
Because you felt you'd broken that bond of trust with the constituents?
Yeah, I think a lot of this is about the way that you exaggerate relationships with people, but I felt that an MP with their constituents is like a priest or a doctor. You have a very special relationship, and that if you break it, you're breaking your vocation.
You know, I mean, I read it. It was a startling thing to read. I have to say, though, in the context of the point you're trying to make, I do want more politicians to feel that seriousness about that bond of trust with the electorate. Because if you don't have that, if you treat the electorate with the kind of casual triviality that Boris Johnson did, or the recklessness that Liz Truss did, or whatever, I think if you do that, democracy slowly starts to die. And if we don't have a strong democracy in this country, I don't know what we're left with.
Thank you. And I think what I'm trying to do in the book, in Politics on the Edge, is to show, yes, a bit of humour, but above all to demonstrate that there is a big, big problem, that this is no way to run a government, and that we need to reform. We need to reform our electoral system. We need to reform ministers going in and out every couple of months out of their jobs to have a serious country.
And you know what else we need, Rory? We need you back in the game. You may not want to do it, but actually I think you should.
Thank you.
You going to?
I think
about it. Has this made you think about it?
It has made me think about it more. And it's made me think that probably the way back in maybe is more local. As I say, I'm very envious of mayors. I thought about running to be an independent mayor of London. And that's still something I think about a lot.
Politics on the Edge. It's a fascinating, it's actually a pretty scary book, actually, because you lift the lid off what we all fear is lying underneath in our parliamentary system. And it's got to evolve and it's got to change. We need more people with your intellect and seriousness, I think, than we currently have. And that would help enormously. Rory Stewart, thank you.
Thank you.
And being uncensored.